अल्लाह रहमान रहीम। टुडे विल बी डिस्कसिंग मल्टीपल मायलोमा विच इज़ अ वेरी इम्पॉर्टेंट टॉपिक एज फार एज दी सब्जेक्ट ऑफ मेडिसिन इज कंसर्न एंड स्पेशली दी हीमाटोलॉजी इज कंसर्न। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल दी लर्निंग ऑब्जेक्टिव्स एट दी एंड ऑफ द लेक्चर I believe you will be able to define the multiple myeloma, you will know the clinical presentation of multiple myeloma and you will know the complication of the multiple myeloma and you will also be able to describe the different modalities or different options of the multiple myeloma and you will finally know the prognosis of the multiple myeloma. The definition of the multiple myeloma is that it is a neoplastic proliferation of single clone of plasma cells. In other words, it is a cancer of the bone marrow or hematological cancer and in which there is production of the monoclonal immunoglobulins and the spectrum ranges from MGUS, which means the monoclonal gammopathy of unknown significance, to plasma cell leukemia. Causes they remain finally the causes remain unknown. However, different propositions have been considered which cause multiple myeloma, and these propositions or causes they range from genetic to environmental, occupational to agriculture. Sometimes the food objects are also considered or implicated in the genesis of the multiple myeloma. And the petrochemical products, insecticides and radiations are certainly have a relation with the causation of the multiple myeloma. Overall, it is 1% of the malignancy in the United States and 10% of the hematological malignancy in the United States. The incidence of the multiple myeloma is 4 to 5 cases per 100,000 cases of the malignancies. The median age at presentation is 60 to 70 years and rarely it occurs less than 40 years of the victims or the patients, but this percentage is very low, that is only 2%. However, the cases have been reported in which the age ranges from 40 to 80 years of age. But these numbers are, since the means have been calculated, therefore the median age at presentation is calculated out to be about 60 to 70 years or 60 to 66 years. Now the presentation, first the symptoms, they are variable symptoms, rather there is a wide variation in the presentation of the symptom depending upon the which part of the body or which organ of the body is implicated or involved first. Sometimes only bone marrow is involved, sometimes only the kidney is involved, at times the patient presents with the hepatosplenomegaly and at times the patient presents with the pneumonia. However, most commonly the patient presents to you with the bony pains, which is about 67%, and sometimes the patient presents only with the fractures, which are the pathological fractures, which means that the patient does not have any accident or does not suffer from any injury or doesn't have a history of fall, and the patient develops spontaneous fractures or pathological fractures. So that raises a high suspicion of the multiple myeloma, in addition to the other causes like vitamin deficiencies, in which there are patients sometimes vitamin D deficiencies, in which sometimes the patient present with the fractures, but there are, in those cases, there are some evidences of mild trauma. The second features, as far as the symptoms are concerned, the patient may present with weakness and fatigue in about 30% of the patients. So, this is a sort of vague complaint and the percentage is very high, but yet the patient is suffering from multiple myeloma. And the patient may also have a weight history of weight loss The patient may also have asthenia, which means the fatigue and malaise. Malaise, it is also very common. I mean, the vague symptom, it can be caused by many causes, but still you should keep in mind that the patient who has recurrently presenting to you, is recurrently presenting to you with the asthenia, you should keep in mind, maybe the patient is a case of multiple myeloma. Sometimes the patient has shortness of breath, if the lung is involved, or the patient is having anemia or pancytopenia. In that case, the patient may have sometimes resting dyspnea, but mostly the patient will be having exertional shortness of breath. Fever is there, but its percentage is very less in the initial stages of the disease. But as the disease advances or becomes, in the design, it falls under the design of the treatable disease, then the patient presents with recurrent fevers. Especially the patient may present with the UTIs, pyelonephritis, and sometimes the patient presents with the recurrent pneumonias. So the patient will be having fever also. And sometimes the patient presents with the signs of the spinal cord compression. And you know, the cord compression once produced, the patient will be having spastic paraplegia. The density of the lesion will depend the weakness of the lower limbs, because the patient sometimes present with backache or lumbago, and people think of lumbago sciatica syndrome commonly. But once at the simultaneously, if the patient is having weakness of the limbs, maybe paresis or paraplegia, but of the spastic type, then you should consider that the patient is perhaps suffering from cord compression, and in that case patient will be having hypertonia, hyperreflexia, and upgoing plantar or positive Babinski's kind. And certainly the patient does have a sensory level which will determine that which vertebrae are involved and what is the dermatome involved. So the level will also be there, and the patient will sensory level will also be there, and the patient will be having simultaneously the spastic paraplegia. Then the repeated infections, earlier I mentioned that most common repeated infections are pneumonia and pyelonephritis, because the multiple myeloma invade the lungs commonly and the kidneys very commonly. Sometimes it is so common that we have the term used or coined is myeloma kidneys. The myeloma kidneys are usually larger in size, but they are repeatedly infected, and the patient, sometimes the doctor is disguised that he remains confined to the pyelonephritis, but he fails to diagnose the disease. But you should keep in mind that those patients who are presenting with the pyelonephritis again and again, you should keep your idea of flight high, and you should consider the multiple myeloma as early as possible. Now, you see, these are the myeloma cells in which the cytoplasm is blue, nucleus is edging to one side or eccentric, and there is a pale zone surrounding the nucleus, and that pale zone is known as halo around the nucleus, or perinuclear pale zone or halo. So these are typical of the plasma cells. Once you do the bone marrow biopsy and do the microscopy, these kind of cells, if found on the bone marrow biopsy followed by the microscopy, these kind of cells, if found, you should instantly say that these are the myeloma cells, and the diagnosis is certain, which is multiple myeloma. Continuing the presentation, presenting features, then you look for the signs. Now, when you examine the patient may have pallor because of the anemia, and patient may have bleeding because of the thrombocytopenia. Coagulation cascade is very rarely implicated in the causation of bleeding, but commonly the thrombocytopenia is the underlying factor when the patient presents to you with the bleeding, and that is a case of multiple myeloma, rarely. Similarly, organomegaly is very common, but the lymph nodes are also found in cases of multiple myeloma. And the organs involved are usually liver and spleen. They are enlarged most commonly, what we call as hepatosplenomegaly. Then radiculopathy with or without cord compression may be there in about 5% of the cases. Radiculopathy, the patient, the multiple nerves, single or multiple nerves are involved, and the patient may have pains, and the patient may have numbness and weakness of the area or muscle supplied by those nerves. So the radiculopathy is a common feature. Similarly, peripheral neuropathy, in where there is maybe motor weakness as well as the sensory signs may also be there. And myopathy may be proximal as well as the distal. The generalized, because of the generalized weakness and the generalized involvement of the nerves and the cord, the patient may also develop the myopathy, and underlying factor may be involvement of the bones and the muscles. So that is where the patient develops myopathy. And the patient may have positive tunnel sign, which means if you strike at the carpal tunnel of the, if you strike at the carpal tunnel, the patient feels tingling and numbness in the palm and fingers. Similarly, in the other sign is Phelan sign. In the Phelan signs, when you hyperflex both the wrist joints and join them together, the patient will feel the tingling and numbness in the both the hands. Next, the patient may have signs of renal failure. Now, signs of renal failure may be, the patient may present to you with the periorbital puffiness followed by the pedal edema. Patient may have oliguria. Patient may have burning micturition, and the patient may have overall edema, ascites, pleural effusion, etc. Once the renal failure advances, and I have seen cases in which the patient presented to us with the advanced renal failure. Next is the HEAT examination. HEAT stands for head, ear, eye, nose and throat examination, and in which the patient may complain of blurring of the vision, pupils may be normal and the pupil may be dilated and fixed, and the patient may have also icterus or jaundice, and the patient may have parotid pain because of the parotid gland involvement. I mean the infiltration of the myeloma cells into the parotid gland. That is why the patient will complain of the parotid pain. Similarly, the patient may have retinal hemorrhages or cotton wool spots. These retinal hemorrhages and cotton wool spots, they are produced by the blockage of the veins in the retina, retinal veins, and that blockage produces the retinal hemorrhages and the cotton wools. These veins, retinal veins, are blocked by the myeloma cells as well as they are blocked by the chains, protein chains or immunoglobulin chains, which are produced in the myeloma in the myeloma, multiple myeloma. These chains are they are different kinds of chains. We will be discussing in the investigations. Anyhow, the blockage of the retinal veins produces the retinal hemorrhages or cotton wool spots because of the cells as well as with the proteins. Now, continuing the sign, the patient may have, now you see the patient, when you examine the skin of the patient may have pallor, patient may have ecchymosis or purpura. Both are because of the thrombocytopenia, and pallor is because of the anemia commonly found in the multiple myeloma because of the involvement of the, because this is a disease of the bone marrow. Therefore, patient may have pancytopenia, patient may have single line affected. If the patient is red cell series is affected, the patient may have only anemia. If the WBCs are implicated, the patient may have neutropenia. If the platelets are platelets are involved, the patient may have thrombocytopenia, and with that the patient may have ecchymosis or purpura. And sometimes the patient does have extramedullary plasmacytomas, and the common sites for the plasmacytomas are the skin, GI tract, prostate and the orbit. And sometimes they are found on the back of the body, they are also found on the limb, the abdomen. I have seen personally these cases during my personal experience of working in the medical units, and they look like swellings on different parts of the body, and you may be disguised if you are so gullible, they look like as they are lipomas or they are neurofibromas, but actually they are plasmacytomas. Next, the patient may have bony tenderness or pain without tenderness. So keep in mind that only bony tenderness and sometimes the pain without tenderness may be the sign. The patient, already discussed, does present with hepatosplenomegaly very commonly because it is a hematological malignancy, and there is extramedullary hematopoiesis as well. Therefore, the patient develops hepatosplenomegaly. Cardiomegaly can also be found. It can be picked by ECG, it can be picked by echocardiography, but the clinical presentation will be those of the patient will present to you with the cardiac failure because of the cardiomegaly. The patient will have pedal edema to start with, he will have orthopnea, shortness of breath, and that shortness of breath will be on mild exertion. And again, this is because of the variable the phenomena underlying the cardiomegaly. Maybe because of the pancytopenia or anemia leading to high cardiac output failure, and also because of the involvement of the myocardium of the heart, because of the myeloma chains, the patient develop cardiomegaly. The characteristic shoulder pad sign. Now, this is you can see in this picture, the patient is having the prominent or large shoulder pads on both sides. These are the anterior aspects of the shoulder joints. They are swollen or prominent, and there is deposition of the light chains in these shoulder anterior aspect of the shoulder joints. That is why they become paddy, and actually there is deposition of the light chains in those pads. And they are also be found in some other diseases which I will be discussing in the differential diagnosis. The patient, when you examine the tongue of the patient may have macroglossia or enlarged tongue. And when you perform the proctoscopy, for instance, the patient as per chance may have hemorrhoids, and you perform the proctoscopy, the patient may develop post-proctoscopic peripalpebral purpura. I mean the purpura around the palpebrae of the eyes. I mean you perform the proctoscopy and you will be finding the purpura around the palpebrae of the eyes. The carpal tunnel syndrome I have demonstrated to you, in which the patient will be having tunnel sign positive, which means that when you strike the carpal tunnel, the patient will be having tingling and numbness of that particular hand. If it is unilateral and if the carpal tunnel syndrome is bilateral, then the tunnel sign will be positive bilaterally. The subcutaneous nodules may also be there. These nodules are smaller than the plasma cytomas. But if nodules, you should take the biopsy and you should think of the multiple myeloma also. Now, investigations or workup, you start with the complete blood count with differential count, and you should also go for the peripheral smear. And ESR is very high in these cases. In most of the cases, the ESR is greater than 100, and peripheral smear will be showing you the pancytopenia like pictures, and the multiple myeloma cells are not usually found in the peripheral smear because they are achieved or retrieved by the bone marrow biopsy. In the anemia, along with in the CBC along with anemia, there will be rollio formation. Next, you do the checkup for the chemistries of the patient, in which the patient may have hypercalcemia, the patient's creatinine may be high depending upon the level of the involvement of the kidney. If the patient is heading towards the advanced renal failure, then the creatinine level may be as high as about 7, 8 or 10 milligram per deciliter. The total proteins are increased, uric acid may be high because of the cell turnover, and the C-reactive protein is sometimes very high. The level of the C-reactive protein is very high. Then SPEP or serum protein electrophoresis with immunofixation, identifies the proteins which are implicated in the causation of the multiple myeloma. And urinary protein electrophoresis, 24-hour urinary protein electrophoresis, they are also specific tests, both. And both have sensitivity ranging from 80-75% to 75%. Then the serum free light chain assay is done. In the serum free light chain assays, you check the kappa and lambda chains, and they are found in high ranges, and sometimes the kappa is higher and sometimes the lambda is higher. Now serum and urine for monoclonal proteins. Monoclonal proteins are produced because the plasmacytomas or myeloma cells, they may be monoclonal region, therefore they will be producing the monoclonal proteins. That is why in the serum as well as in the urine, you will be finding monoclonal type of the proteins. Then you check the 24-hour urine for Banks-Jones proteins, which are actually the lambda chains. And then beta 2 microglobulin, they are also raised. They are so raised in other diseases like amyloidosis, but they have some specificity related to the multiple myeloma, so therefore they are also raised in the multiple myeloma. I mean the beta 2 microglobulin levels will be higher. Albumin will be high also, and LDH will also be very high. Then finally the bone marrow biopsy will be a deciding factor, and do the histopathology, and you do the microscopy, and you will be finding the multiple myeloma cells which I have described earlier, and I have shown the slide also, in which the cytoplasm of the myeloma cell is blue, the nucleus is purple, it is eccentric, and it is surrounded by a halo or pale area around the nucleus. So next you check the cytogenetics. In the cytogenetics you check the chromosomal abnormalities, I mean the karyotyping, and similarly some mutations or translocations, they are detected by the cytogenetics. Then you check the FISH test or fluorescence in situ hybridization, in which the mutations or enzymes or proteins are detected by the technique known as FISH. And the deletions which may be found by this technique as well as with the cytogenetics, they may be at chromosome number 13, and the translocations may be between chromosome number 4 and chromosome number 14, and similarly the translocations may be between chromosome number 11 and chromosome number 14. Then the X-rays or skeletal survey is done, in which you will be finding the lytic lesions, maybe on the skull, maybe on the long bones, including the humerus and including the femur of the body. Then the MRI should also be done of the whole body, in which the spinal cord is checked and the paraspinal areas are checked, and you can find the even the minute lesions in the bones, surrounding the bones, etc. And you can also see the involvement of the nerves in the MRI. Then lesions of the thorax are also be picked by the MRIs. Lumbar spine area lesions are also picked, paraspinal areas are picked, and the cord compression is detected by the MRI. Then PET scan is also performed or may be performed. It is not mandatory. If you have made the diagnosis with the above mentioned investigations, they are sufficient, rather more than sufficient, but sometimes you need to have to finalize the diagnosis. In that case, you can do the positron emission tomography scan, and in that scan you can also pick the other tumors also. So for differentiation purpose as well, it will be helping you for differentiation the multiple myeloma from other diseases. Now see in this picture, these are the lytic lesions, and again these are the lytic lesions in the skull. These are the lytic lesions in the skull, and similarly these are the plasmacytomas here in the paraspinal area, and again in the transverse section these are the plasmacytomas in the paraspinal areas. Now these are again the lytic lesion. See the network like lytic lesion in the ulna of the in the ulna, and also in the radius of the upper arm, lower arm, and see the humerus has also lytic lesions. Now see the patient complaining of backache. The patient complaining of backache, and the patient is having the involvement with the multiple infiltration of the vertebral bodies with the myeloma cells and the chains as well. The patient may have involvement of the arms, and the patient may have involvement of the head of the femur. See, in this case the lumbar spine is involved, and these are the myeloma cell infiltration as well as the chain infiltration in one vertebral body. So much is the peculiar evidence regarding the multiple myeloma, where the bones are involved and they are invaded by the myeloma factors. I mean the cells as well as the chains. Now again, the same peripheral picture, the marrow picture, in which the patient is having the typical myeloma cells, and after bone marrow biopsy, and the patient may have marrow plasma cytosis greater than 10% if the myeloma cells are found in the bone marrow. More than 10%, the diagnosis is certain, and it should also have a surface markers, CD markers 138, which should be monoclonal. And then the focal bone marrow involvement. Sometimes not the whole of the bone marrow is involved, only some portions or some bones are involved, and your biopsy may fail. Then you have to repeat the biopsy from the other possible site. By doing the bone marrow MRI, you can detect the area involved, and then you should repeat the biopsy. In that case, you will be finding the myeloma cells from that part of the bone marrow where it is available. So the multiple biopsies may be required in cases where the patient is having focal bone marrow involvement. Now finally, the diagnosis will be the presence of the serum and or urine monoclonal proteins, which may be IgG, IgA, IgD, and IgE and IgM are also a part of the monoclonal proteins which are present in the multiple myeloma. Then free light chains in about 20% of the cases. I have named them already. They are Banks-Jones proteins, or they may be kappa or lambda free light chains. Then the clonal plasma cells or plasma cytomas are also found on bone marrow biopsy, which are typical. And then the end organ damage can also help you establish the diagnosis. With the end organ damage, the patient will be having hypercalcemia, the patient will be having renal failure, and this is what we call as myeloma kidneys. It is larger in size and it will be heading towards the renal failure because of the infiltration of the chains and because of the possibly the infiltration of the kidney substance by the myeloma cells. And the patient may have anemia because of the renal failure, and the patient may have anemia because of the pancytopenia as part of the multiple myeloma. Lytic lesions are produced very commonly. I have given you the evidence by the pictures or slides, because of the hypercalcemia and involvement of the bone because of the myeloma pathology. Now the main differential diagnosis are based on the elevation of the M protein, that is MGUS or monoclonal gammopathy of unknown significance. It is about 1% per year. The incidence of this MGUS disease is the absence of the symptoms. The patient does not have any symptom, but the M protein level is less than 3 gram per deciliter. It is higher in the myeloma kidneys. And then 10% of the plasma cells in the bone marrow, which are greater than 10% in the multiple myeloma. Patient may have anemia, patient may have renal failure, patient may have hypercalcemia, patient may have lytic lesions, which are, the contenders of the diagnosis. Then smoldering multiple myeloma. The incidence is 10% per year, and it meets the diagnostic criteria for multiple myeloma, but there is no end organ damage. The end organ damages I have previously, immediately back I have mentioned to you, the multiple organs are involved, leading on to the end organ damage. So in the smoldering multiple myeloma, the end organ damage features are not found. That is why it is known as smoldering multiple myeloma. Then primary amyloidosis is a very strong contender of the differential diagnosis of the multiple myeloma, because it is the one in which in the primary type the light chains are produced, which may be lambda or kappa chains, and they may have clinical manifestations ranging from bone involvement to organomegaly. Shoulder pad sign is also positive. The patient may have chest involvement, but there is fibrosis, but it may have superadded infection involved. So the uveitis is also may be found. The patient can get involvement of the spinal cord, brain, eyes, heart, etc. The heart amyloidosis is also a common feature, and you see I said earlier that the patient can have cardiomegaly in multiple myeloma. Similarly, the patient can have cardiomegaly in the amyloidosis also. So next diagnosis is metastatic cancer. Other cancers, they involve the different organs of the body. They involve the liver and spleen, they involve the bone, they can produce the fractures, because the mets can come into the bones and they can produce the fractures. So that is why the metastatic cancer is also a differential diagnosis of the multiple myeloma. Other differential diagnosis, the leukemia, CLL will be differentiated, though the features are variable. They may mimic multiple myeloma, but Smudge cell will be the differentiating point on bone marrow biopsy. Similarly, the B and T cell lymphomas, they are also sometimes present similarly. There are many things in common which are found in multiple myeloma. then non-lymphoid neoplasm like breast carcinoma, chronic myeloid leukemia, very easy to diagnosis on the basis of the Philadelphia chromosome. Sometimes the combination of breast and colonic cancer can also be considered in the differential diagnosis of the multiple myeloma. Cirrhosis of the liver is considered because in the early part of the cirrhosis, the patient may have hepatomegaly, then the patient may have splenomegaly as well. So the multiple myeloma, the patient does have hepatosplenomegaly. In sarcoidosis, all kinds of the features are available which are found in the multiple myeloma. Of course, the differentiating point, and with the help of the investigation, we will be outclassing the sarcoidosis or eliminating the sarcoidosis from the from coming or approaching the multiple myeloma. Then Gaucher disease, the disease of the childhood, and some features common, but ultimately on checkup of the SPEP and UPEP, you can eliminate the Gaucher disease. Pyoderma gangrenosum is a weak contender of the multiple myeloma, and similarly other autoimmune conditions, myasthenia gravis, rheumatoid arthritis, and cold agglutinin disease are also the differential diagnosis. Now, staging of the disease, one is Dury's hormone staging, which is stage 1 to 3 A and B type. It was coined in 1975. It is based on the following factors: presence of the M protein, hypercalcemia, radiographic bone involvement, then the patient's hemoglobin will be less, patient will be having renal failure or the myeloma kidney. So these are the features of the staging. Then the international staging system again ranges from stage 1 to 3, and the basis is the rise in the serum beta 2 microglobulin, and the involvement of the there will be high albumin levels. Now treatment, there are different options starting from the supportive therapy to specific therapy. Now in the supportive therapy, hypercalcemia with bone involvement, you should treat the hypercalcemia. You should offer the adequate fluids and fluids so that the hypercalcemia can be eliminated. Similarly, you should offer the analgesics, and you should try to handle the renal involvement, and you should also consider the plasmapheresis as part of the supportive therapy. The patient does have low threshold for infections or infectious complications, which means they are vulnerable to the infections very easily. And so you should keep in mind that why the patient is suffering from repeated infections. If you suspect that the patient is having repeated infections or recurrent infections like recurrent pneumonia, you should consider multiple myeloma. The patient does have features of hyperviscosity, which there is headache, blurring of vision, vertigo, etc., and tinnitus. And that hyperviscosity can be manageable with the plasmapheresis. Similarly, the neurological manifestations are managed with the palliative radiations, and you can correct the anemia with the help of the RBC transfusion, and you can correct the thrombocytopenia by administering the platelet mega units. And similarly, you can correct the neutropenia with the GCS colony stimulating factor, and which are available with the name of filgristine or filgrastine. Now, one novel agent, turmeric curcumin, it has properties of antioxidants and anti-inflammatory, though they are not curative, but they have some benefits as far as the symptoms of the patients are concerned. But it causes monoglonal gammopathy of unknown significance. Now, initiation of specific therapy. Chemotherapy is the mainstay of the treatment. The drugs which are used in the management of the multiple myeloma. To start with, the thalidomide is offered with or without dexamethasone. The second best choice is melphalan with or without prednisolone. And then the proteasome inhibitor bortezomib is the third option, which has good results if the patient is resistant to thalidomide or melphalan. Nowadays in Pakistan, lenalidomide is being used very commonly singly or as well as in combination with the dexamethasone. I have seen cases being managed with the lenalidomide and dexamethasone. Similarly, a combo of bortezomib, which is a proteasome inhibitor, and melphalan. You see, the melphalan is amongst the drugs which were which is initiated in the early part of the therapy, but now you can combine the newer agents with the initial agents like melphalan. So combination of bortezomib and melphalan has good results or better results. Then finally, the combination of vincristine, adriamycin and dexamethasone or VAD regime is very famous in the treatment of the multiple myeloma. Then all the treatment options have been exercised and the patient's response to the therapy is not very good, not to your desirable results, then you should go for the hematopoietic stem cell transplantation, which is the ultimate treatment of the multiple myeloma. Now finally, the prognosis. When the patient presents in the advanced stage of the disease, the outcome is usually fatal and there is 10 to 20% mortality within first 2 to 3 months. On the whole, the median survival is 4 to 5 years. 5-year survival is about 30%, 10-year survival is 10%, and 15-year survival is 4%. But it has been mentioned that the patient can survive as short as 5 years and the patient can survive as long as up to 25 years. Then the prognosis is also dependent upon the tumor burden. The factors or criteria which are considered in the tumor burden are the levels of the CRP, levels of the beta 2 microglobulins, and these are the one, these predict the survival of the patient. So if the tumor burden is higher, then the survival chances are lesser. If the tumor burden is lesser, the survival of the patient is greater. The survival of the patient improves with the hematopoietic stem cell transplantation. The lambda light chain disease has 3 times worse prognosis than kappa light chain disease. Remember, this is a very fine point which has been raised in the prognosis, that if the patient, now you know earlier I told you there are kappa and lambda chain, sometimes the kappa chains are higher in quantity in the circulation and sometimes the lambda chains are higher in quantity in circulation when you quantify them. If the lambda chains are higher, the ratio of lambda to kappa is higher, then the prognosis is 3 times worse compared to the kappa chain light disease. Now the major causes of death in the prognosis are progressive multiple myeloma. You are treating the patient with the therapies and you have exhausted all the available drugs. Still the disease is rampant or progressing. The renal failure is worsening. The patient has started developing sepsis despite the therapy and the patient develops leukemia because of the chemotherapeutic agents, or the patient develops myeloid dysplasia, then the survival of the or the prognosis of the patient becomes worse, and the 25% of the patient die of age-related illness depending upon the tumor mass or tumor burden. And similarly, hypercalcemia and the presence of the Benz Jones proteins, they are also the predictors in the prognosis of the disease. Any question you can ask, I am available. You can ask the questions in the feedback. Otherwise, you can ask any questions through this channel, through this link by which I am sending you the lecture. I will be happy to answer your questions, because it is a very interesting and important topic as far as the hematology is concerned. Thank you for remaining with me, and I say goodbye to you from Akhtar Seth Trust Hospital.